It's so hard to find a hero anywhere. I was proud of that hitman character. He fought for the right causes, and he spoke up, and he told the truth. He always fought so hard.
I loved being a hero to people around the world. You think of India, where these kids showed up and waited for a whole afternoon for me just to come to the school. They couldn't believe it was like a god coming to the school. They really believed in you, and they really loved you. This is real. This is something you can never buy.
Tomorrow's the big showdown in Montreal. That's probably the biggest fight of my whole life. This great story I've been living for the last 15 years to come to an end.
I talked to Vince, and he goes, you have to lose to Sean in Montreal.
I can't do that. I can't do it. I described it to Vince, I just assume blow my brains out would be the same. About the same, what you're asking me to do. And from a character standpoint, that's what I would be doing. I would be taking Bret the Hitman Hart, would blow his brains out. When people say wrestling, you know, they talk about wrestling not being real. It's far more real than people think.
I have no sympathy for Bret. Whatsoever, none. I have no sympathy for someone not doing the right thing for the business that made him, not doing the right thing for the fans and the performers and the organization who helped make him what he is today. Bret made a very, very selfish decision. Bret's gonna have to live with that for the rest of his life. Bret screwed Bret. I have no sympathy whatsoever for Bret.
Thank you very much.
I've been a professional wrestler for the last 20 years. Most of that time I worked for Vince McMahon and the World Wrestling Federation. It's gotten really big. They say every week, 500 million people watch it all over the world.
Shall we?
All the years I've wrestled, I still get this dream, and I can't stop it once it starts. And it's that same line, they're playing you music for the second time, you know, it's like, and I'm never up stark naked, and I'm like the last match or something, and I've been telling myself all along, like, you dumbass, you should have, get ready, please get ready, and I never listen, I'm always, you know.
You know, I made a promise, and I stick to my word, and I live up to my promises, and that promise is that I'm gonna be a world wrestling. What's gonna happen in the SummerSlam? Am I really gonna, if... And I promised all my fans across Canada, and I fought.
Fred, what's the deal? You think you're ready?
No, I don't think I'm pretty.
You think everybody wanna play ha-ha with you, man?
I didn't say I was pretty, and I don't wanna play ha-ha with anybody.
See, he looks like and acts like my wife. Very bad combination. Hell on wheels. It looks like he has an easygoing disposition, but he has the personality of a rattlesnake.
My youngest one's 7. Girl, boy. Yeah, they've all been up and down. Like,
because you either had your kids when you were 12 or you really aged well.
I'm 40. Just turned 40 a week ago.
Did you really?
Yeah.
Well, you don't look it.
Thanks. I will after tonight's match.
These days, I wrestle with the Hart Foundation. Well, there's my brother-in-law, the British Bulldog. He's probably the strongest guy in wrestling. And there's my brother Owen, who's probably one of the best sort of high-flying technical wrestlers in the game today. And then there's my brother-in-law, Jim the Anvil Neidhart. He's a character.
And Jim, you close it.
With?
Close it with,
Are you going to continue to fight or you want me to stay here, Vince?
We're going to get hungry.
You're going to stay here with a verbal.
We're going to get hungry and forget our manners.
We're going to get hungry and forget our manners.
Yeah, baby, or whatever. What's that? Why don't you say whatever you want to say? I don't need to tell you what to say.
Where'd you think of that at?
I got it in a book of quotes.
We're going to get hungry and forget our manners.
Yeah. How about this one? Leave no man untested.
Leave no man untested. We're going to get hungry. We're going to get hungry and leave no man untested.
No, no. No.
Everybody, Brett,
and right now, I would like to bring in none other than Bret Hart and the Hart Foundation. Well, Bret, I'd say you guys have what you want. Tonight, we got the five best sharpshooters in the history of the World Wrestling Federation. Bang.
You know, Doctor, sum it up, the Hart Foundation, we're going to get hungry, and we're going to forget our manners.
This has got to do with the survival of the fittest. And we're gonna find out tonight if you got what it takes to be the strong one in this match. Tell him, Hawk.
I got one thing to say. What a rush.
Stone Cold, Stone.
Wrestling has and always will be filled with some of the most unbelievable, bizarre, outrageous characters.
Goldust pushes a gay, homophobic button and pushes it really hard. A lot of people took great offense to him.
I'm Samuel, and I'm managing these guys tonight. I flew in from Saskatchewan. And yes, we're gonna have a nice time tonight. Oh, yes, indeed we are. You go, girl.
He's anything but the character that he plays.
He's a Texas hick with cowboy boots and country music.
It's a male soap opera. It makes you crazy.
Some people, I think, ask wrestling, are they a real sport? But it's not sport. It's sports entertainment. It's there to fulfill your needs, to give you something extra to look forward to.
It's fun. There's not a whole lot of things in life that are fun anymore. You have your favorites, you cheer them. You have your people you don't like, you boo them. You know, you don't have to worry about somebody punching you in the face because you boo them, because that's their job.
Vader, he's a big baby. You know, you can hurt his feelings real easily.
Cut the music! It's time! It's time!
Yeah, I have a degree in business, and I'm also a licensed real estate broker, and I'm currently developing about 100,000 square foot shopping center.
There, she's kicking off those high heels, folks.
She's gonna get down now.
Yes, sir.
I know, that's right.
She better not take anything
These
else off.
These shows are killing me!
She can take anything off she wants to, Rob.
Sunny, she's very flirtatious, on and off screen. To me, she's just a good friend, and that's all, just a friend.
You're gonna give me some warning?
I'll give you more warning.
I remember one time, I think I was getting a little bit older, I might have been 12. I was right on the aisle, and they hit the Bret Hart music, and he comes walking down in his pink tights, still wore pink tights, he had shorter hair, and of course everybody reaches out their hand, and I remember him slapping my hand, and it was just like, wow, Bret Hart touched my hand. I'd tell him that now, because I'll probably make him feel kind of funny.
Shawn Michaels! Look at that!
Shawn Michaels is a great athlete. He's an incredible performer in the ring. There's things about him that really get on my nerves. He's got this prima donna personality. I mean, he thinks he's better than everyone else. And there's something very arrogant and obnoxious about him, something very unlikable.
And welcome to WrestleMania 3!
The stage we perform on was created by Vince McMahon.
America, the beautiful!
He's the driving force and creative genius behind the WWF. He really turned wrestling upside down and changed it completely.
Go get him, champ.
And me, I'm Brett the Hitman Hart. Now, your kids are pretty safe if they're watching me on Saturday mornings. I send out a pretty wholesome message.
Wow.
The Hitman stands for sticking up for yourself and to never quit. The one thing I won't do is lie to my fans. I've really only worked for two promoters in my whole career, Vince McMahon, and I've worked for my father, Stu Hart. I spent most of my career trying to prove myself to Vince. But deep down, I guess I know it's always been about my dad. My parents had 8 boys and 4 girls. All 8 boys got into wrestling, and all 4 girls married wrestlers. Not quite what my mother had in mind.
When we were married, I said to Stu, how long will we be in this business? He said, about 2 years. So 20 years later, I said, Stu, we're still in this. I can't like it. I didn't then, and it's worse now than ever. I said, well, I don't want the boys in it, any of the boys, and I want the girls marrying wrestlers above all, you know. Anyhow, you know, the rest of the story, they're all involved. We couldn't be any into it any more deeply than we are, you know. It's a whole, everything is wrestling.
The person I've always longed to be or tried to be is you. I mean, I've over and over I've tried to think like you, and what would my dad do in this situation?
I know that was here too, all the good things they said about me.
Oh, they are true.
How are you?
It wasn't easy growing up with a legend for a father. He told us stories of how hard life was and how tough and stubborn his father was. In a dispute over some land, his dad wound up in jail.
Stu and his 2 sisters ended up in a foster home.
It was there that he discovered wrestling. He fell in with a club of shooters. That's real submission wrestlers. They had a great time stretching Stu and pretty much grinding him up. The idea of the game was that they would give you so much punishment that you'd just give up and not come back.
Well, they'd put your head in between your knees and pull your knees up over your head, and your head would be getting blue by the time you got out of there. They would crank you up as tight as they could make you without actually separating life from the body, you know. Every day I was stretched pretty good. And I was anxious to learn, anxious to be a bully, you know.
Stu never gave up. It wasn't long before Stu was giving out all the punishment. To dish out that kind of pain and receive that kind of pain, that's sort of what made a man of you. Yeah, I got a lot of that in me, too. You survive by taking the pain in, getting hit, hitting back, being very physical, and letting out all your aggressions. I think you grow up with it. It helped prepare me for professional wrestling, where you have to be able to take a lot of abuse. Those early days with my dad helped me come up with a submission hold of my own. My finishing move, the sharpshooter. You win when the other guy tells the referee that he can't take the pain anymore and he gives up. It takes a lot of skill and a lot of talent to make it all look real.
My personal philosophy on wrestling is that the real art of professional wrestling is to do it like full contact and everything. To do it, you should never get hurt. If you ever get hurt, it's because somebody did something wrong. And you should never hurt anybody else. Like, I can do wrestling. I've been wrestling 20 years. I've never hurt anybody. I mean, it's been full contact and very physical. But when you come back to the dressing room after, you should be able to put your boots on and go home. And, you know, like, you had a long day, but you know, no more than a football player or anybody else. But to purposely or intentionally hurt yourself or hurt someone else is, like, There's no art in that.
50 pounds!
Watch my punches. My punches are very credible. You watch them, you go, he connected on all of those. I've kicked people full blast in the face. But do you ever wonder for 1 second, like, why there's no big bruise after? You know, there is an art to wrestling.
But people never come up and say, you're a hell of an actor.
And it seems like I've been defending wrestling my whole life. When I was growing up, to the other kids, we were just this weird wrestling family, and they loved to taunt us.
They like to call us heart fart, which was, I hate that.
Most of all, they tormented us about wrestling. They used to say that my dad was a fake, that their whole wrestling business was a fraud and a joke, and the worst thing they could say that it was phony, that your dad's a phony. That was always the one thing that got you started. My sisters got teased terribly. They were often in tears.
This went on for about a year or two. I remember George was really miserable. She was crying just about every night, you know. I mean, it was horrible. Your whole life was being just ruined by this. You didn't even want to go to school.
You know, every once in a while, you know, my brothers are going to come and beat you up one of these days.
But I knew that there was this big kid that had been bullying my sister quite a bit, Georgia, and he was way much too big for me.
But this one kid decided Brett probably wouldn't be so tough without the brothers, you know. And this kid had 2 years on Brett and was a fairly salty little bully, actually. And so after school, he decided that he was going to go at it again with Brett.
And I remember I sat and I thought about it and I thought about it and I thought about it all afternoon. And I finally decided that I could beat this guy.
It came down to one big showdown, kind of like at the OK Corral.
I walked out through the gates. I remember there was a teacher that wished me luck. I was pretty much going to get my butt kicked. I walked into the alley for the big fight. Threw the big wild punches and stuff, and he got his hands up right away again, and I took him down, and this time I made good on it, and I hammered him into the ground and really pounded the crap out of him, and they hoisted me up on their shoulders. And it was really strange, because I remember when I won the title, all the wrestlers came in the ring, which I had no idea they were gonna do. I think Vince McMahon sent them in, and they hoisted me up on their shoulders. Right away, I said, I was hearing grade eight at Vincent Massey. I said, it was the exact same feeling.
It was one of those great moments in life, you know, you just finally the hero prevails.
What the other kids didn't understand was at all, us hard kids, it was all real. All you had to do was walk into the living room and hear the sounds that came out of the dungeon, out of the basement. These guys screaming for their lives. I mean, to me, that was about as real as it could get.
He'd find guys at the Y to come up to the house to work out with him in the gym. And he just loved it when guys say, oh, I want to get in the ring. Stu, I'm going to kill that stomper. I'll tear him limb from limb. And I just say, hey, that sounds great, Tiger. Yeah, maybe you could come up to the gym and I'll give you a few pointers, or maybe you could even show me a thing or two. And he'd rub his hands together, and he'd almost start salivating at the idea of this eager young guy.
I've had enough.
You could hear it through the living room. There's a hole in the floor where the pipes have to go, and it goes straight through to the gym. My brother Bruce sent Owen in once to tape record this one guy. He was actually really pathetic. He was crying and weeping through the whole thing. There's some country western song in the background, and this guy screaming, and my dad saying, have some discipline.
Have some discipline. Have some discipline.
They'd go quiet for a little bit. You know that my dad was cinching up on the guy. 10 or 15 seconds later, the guy screaming. That was the measure of a man, just to see who would submit. Who would give up, and it was based on pain. You didn't give up unless you couldn't take it anymore.
So you're gonna show where you stretch all those people? So you're gonna show us the dungeon?
I might try to show a move or two.
I'm ready. Yeah. I'll take some moves, sir.
It sounded so terrible. This guy was sounded like a sadist and almost a psychopath. You gotta know my dad to know that he isn't. He's just a perfect, gentle, loving guy.
I don't want to hold this in this position forever because it's pretty.
I don't feel my arms, sir.
You see, you got a lot of push here. And then I shove with my chest here. I shove him.
I can feel it.
Can you feel that, sir?
Oh, yes, sir.
Red hair, rosy.
Yes, sir.
And by taking this arm back here, like here, it's not much pressure on him.
No.
But you just ease his hand in the position here. It's a matter of separating the body from the past. I got the power here to
stop it, sir. Stop.
Soon he'll go to sleep. The throat muscles get so tight that the almost roots of your tongue almost burst.
Oh, yes, sir.
And then your eyes start getting a little rosy looking.
That's why I couldn't feel nothing there. I was
I've never seen a fellow yet when you got the thing properly applied that you couldn't make his eyeballs bloodshot for maybe sometimes 5 or 6 weeks or so with the red rosy eyeballs. You know, you see,
I don't feel nothing.
Look at the veins in his temples. They're getting, your lips are getting a little blue, sort of. And you're getting.
I can remember my dad squeezing me so hard that the blood vessels would break behind your eyeballs kind of thing. And you go to school the next day with blood red eyes. If you could get to the top of the mountain, which is his word for screaming for your life, were you actually screaming and pleading and begging for your life, which Lord knows I did on numerous occasions. And my dad was always screaming it in your ear that this was your last breath. You know, you've breathed your last breath. I can remember that ringing in my ears lots of times and thinking, I probably have. Maybe this is the end. I often sort of envision the newspaper headlines sort of spinning around going, professional wrestler goes too far. And then he would just get up and leave.
I was deathly afraid of my father.
I see through my father's eyes a little more, and I know that it must have been a real tough thing to do to raise 12 kids. And I have great respect for him now, and I think of a lot of what he did. It was the way kids were raised in those days, just how he was brought up.
When I think of my dad's dungeon, I think all the sort of the real pain and the guys really screaming out. And maybe that's the difference between me and my dad, so I'd much rather have like a little toy rubber guy down here screaming.
It's so bizarre to think that I want to have that in my house.
But it's pretend. For me, it was all too many times it wasn't pretend.
And I never had any desire or plans to ever become a professional wrestler. That was definitely where I wasn't gonna go. I made up my mind to go into film.
My dad wanted me to go into amateur wrestling. In Stu's eyes, I was going to the Olympics. That was his dream, not mine. He ran a promotion called Stampede Wrestling.
There's a little gritting from Stu Hart. I'll ask my dad to be my tag partner.
It happened in seconds. My dad needed some guys, and all of a sudden I was a professional wrestler.
Remember this, Bret Hart. You can't run to Papa.
In comes Stu.
By then, the wrestling business was losing money hand over fist. The thought of it going broke was tearing my mother apart.
And then Bret Hart gives the younger Hart version.
Hello, everyone. This is Vince McMahon reporting.
It wasn't long after that I met Vince. My dad sold his territory to him and changed my life forever.
A piece of history in the making.
Stu was out of business, and I was in the WWF.
If anyone had to adjust to life without wrestling, it was my father. It was a really tough thing for him. I suppose in my own way, I went through some pretty tough experiences. I find a lot of parallels with what my father went through right from the very, very beginning. I've had to claw my way up to the top. So I don't think it was ever handed to me. I found myself really fighting hard to actually survive and come out of it, actually to come out of the wrestling profession someday as a success rather than a wrestling tragedy, which is what so many of them turn out.
Here, this is kind of interesting. Here, you were the most famous Albertan in the world. It's kind of unusual.
I think I end up maybe being the most famous Canadian in the world, too. For a few minutes, but anyway.
I've been working for Vince McMahon's WWF for the last 14 years. I always figured I'd end my career there. And then Ted Turner's WCW made me an incredible offer to jump sides and come work for them. An enormous amount of money.
How you feeling?
Tired.
You asleep?
I lost the turn all day.
Probably the biggest decision of my entire life. They've offered me $9 million over 3 years, which is, you know, when I got into wrestling, beyond anything I ever imagined.
And here comes the owner of the World Wrestling Federation, Vince McMahon.
Vince McMahon came to me and he offered me for a lot less money, but he offered me a 20-year contract. And, right now it's like I have a really tough time kind of putting my loyalty and everything in front and trying to figure out what's the right thing to do, because money's not always the most important thing. And at the same time, I feel like the prettiest girl at the dance, and I got everyone kind of vying for my attention. And yet at the same time, this is like a major war between these two huge companies. Vince McMahon used to be like the king of wrestling until Ted Turner decided to get into it. From my standpoint, and for a little guy from Calgary, these two huge, giants in the world are fighting over me. My contract is up, and I'm free to go anywhere I want to, and it should be a really simple decision. Just take the money. I've always wanted to make some money and finally go home and be secure.
The Hitman Bret Hart, ready to electrify this
capacity. Vince McMahon made me. He gave me the stage to work on and the opportunity to show everybody that I was the best of them.
Unbelievable. Congratulations. Congratulations.
And the fact that he gave me that chance and made my dreams come true is something that weighs really heavy in whatever the decision is that I have to make. The thing is, should I stay or should I go? And for me, $9 million is a lot of money.
You get offered a great offer and you have to decide which one you're gonna take. Nobody has any idea how much soul searching I've done over this. But when it comes right down to it, to everything I've ever done and everything I ever plan on ever doing, I owe it all to my WWF fans. Well, I'll be with the WWF forever.
And you wouldn't even be the only wrestler in the neighborhood. The Shrieking Sheik lives just 3 doors away.
Hey, I'll take it.
I mean, you have to show some common sense, and first of all, you have to do what's right for your family. But I mean, how much money do you need sometimes? I find myself torn between trying to do the right thing for my family and at the same time show my loyalties.
You can save money with a can rail pass.
Japan.
Mark.
Europe.
What is Canada? That's where I'm Mark.
Tell me the greatest of them.
Yes, Father.
Can
you come in?
A lot of peas, Dad.
I think my relationship with Vince McMahon was always sort of like a father. And I sort of saw myself, if I left, it would have been a little bit like leaving my dad, especially when the chips are down. The WCW is breathing down his neck. They've overtaken him in the ratings.
It's easy to jump and switch sides then and say, well, thanks for everything. Loyalty's important.
So I was back in the WWF. It wasn't long before I had a match in my own hometown, in front of my father and Vince McMahon. This was gonna be a big show for me.
Whooping Vince's jacket like this.
I can remember my first meetings with Vince. I was always very suspect of him, a little awestruck by him. It was a little bit like my relationship with my father as a kid, where I was intimidated by him and I didn't want to get in his way.
God almighty, you're getting big. You ever grown in those feet? You're going to be like... One day you're going to be looking down on your dad, and you're going to be walking up like this, and you say, Dad, I don't want to do that.
You're like, Dad, Mom wants you to leave the room now.
Vince has creative control, and he decides the direction of all the matches.
All right, go mess around. Go bother the headbangers or something. All right? I got to just talk.
Once the story's all set, it's up to me to work it all out. I figured seeing as though Stu and all my brothers were there, we might as well try to involve them somehow in the storyline.
Hey, Bruce, maybe you should come in on this thing here. Dave?
Yeah.
Can you come back in that room and work?
Yeah.
If we don't work some stuff out.
Yeah, I know. I'm just telling him.
Once I've worked out a general plan with Vince, I usually search out Pat Patterson and figure out how the match will go.
And Smith can be like trying to get on, and finally when it's over with, he can jump in the ring, everybody else can jump in the ring.
Yeah.
But these two should be fighting with, explain it to them.
He's one of those guys can visualize what's gonna happen in a wrestling match. I see it all happen before it ever happens in my head, maybe like the way a movie director does.
You need to hit him, I guess, from behind with a big drink.
Yeah.
When you hit him with the drink, he's going to turn around.
On the other side of the rail, Barry.
Yeah, you're on the other side of the rail.
Yeah.
You want to give the impression that Steve is going to supposedly think that Stu threw the drink, which is bullshit.
Just tell him to get close.
Could even be Stu's drink, which would be funny.
He gets close.
Because remember, Austin.
Come on, dag out. Just don't get mad, you know. If you're not ready to do a spot, then you get ready to go home. Just don't get mad. Somebody's got to tell somebody.
Jump in the ring and get going into it right away.
Wow, well, let's all give our glasses away.
Great. And then you jump in the fucking
ring. Go in the ring
and
then just go, me and Steve.
Just go, bing,
boom. Everyone else powders out.
You know, smoke clears and it's you and Steve.
Can settle it down after we go at it.
Yeah.
And Steve can go toe-to-toe, get it up, and then settle it down, maybe.
Right, because you have to settle it down if you're going to do 40 minutes. If you both end up outside the ring, where your brothers are, and let's say he knocks you on your ass on the floor, and one of your brothers are trying to reach in, he turns around, nails one of your brother, kicks that motherfucker on the leg.
Ah!
He just came back in a wounded leg. Go home from there? Does that work for you?
Yeah, maybe.
Steve is going to think that Stu threw the drink, which is bullshit.
I'd like to see him even push Stu. Just push him.
Mm-hmm. You don't have to do anything or hurt him. Stu would get off on it.
Then he just sits, boom, falls back on his chair. Nail your brother. And the other one says, fuck you. Jumps over the barricade, kicks. Oh, fuck. You get nut, throw his ass in the fucking ring. And either your brother fucking help you when everybody else is fighting in the ring, motherfucker. Fucking no good bastard.
One, two, three.
That's the story.
But behind the curtain, it's anything but fake what it takes to become a professional wrestler. We push ourselves to the limits, and even the best wrestlers have accidents. Was the time when I
never ever thought about getting hurt, just worried about screwing up, period. Now I don't worry about screwing up, I just worry about getting hurt.
Did you ever hear the story, boy, when I broke my sternum? You know what a sternum is? That's this bone right here. Right there. I don't even know if you got one. Right there on me.
It was in Toronto when I was wrestling a guy called Dino Bravo. And all in the matter of seconds, I got knocked off the apron into the steel fence. I had just hit the fence across my entire chest and sternum. I broke all my ribs. Thought I was suffocating. I didn't know if I'd punctured my lung. I didn't know what happened. I just knew I got hurt really bad. I couldn't take a breath. And I think the most horrible part about it was so many people on the front row there screaming at me to get up, you phony. It was scary, you know, that people actually thought this was all part of the show. For all I know, I could die here on the ground. The wrestler I was wrestling finally came out of the ring because I couldn't speak. He assumed I was okay and proceeded to stomp me across the chest. This guy was really strong, just picked me right up and tossed me back in the ring. He was a wrestler I didn't particularly want to lose to. There was a one, two, and I put my foot on the ropes, which was my own dumb move, but I just refused to lose to this guy. He stomped me a couple more times, and eventually got myself counted out, and they took me out of there in an ambulance.
I was out for about 7 weeks. They promised me they would look after me. But after a while, I realized that the checks weren't going to get any better than a couple $100 a week. So I was back in the ring way sooner than I should have been.
Ladies and gentlemen, a reminder to visit your World Wrestling Federation concession stands.
Man, you're going to have to walk on my neck. My neck is killing me. You know where it's killing me? Right there. Those muscles right there.
Right there?
No. Right there. Oh, yeah. You got to walk on there with your big feet. How was the neck little massage I gave you yesterday?
When I was faced with this decision to either stay with the WWF or get lured into the WCW, I had this loyalty to Vince McMahon, but I think there's also something more important than that.
Here we go!
What would happen to the Hitman character? What would the WCW do with that character? And I had to reflect back and go, I know one thing, in the WWF, I'll always be able to go out the hero. So like it's been for most of the last decade, I was the number one good guy in wrestling again. The key to being a great good guy is being able to work with a great bad guy.
What do you gotta do to beat this man?
A lot of thought goes into creating an evil character. Mankind is one of my favorites.
Hey Brett, I'm gonna try to be finished with this book by the time you go.
Well, Mankind's like the Hannibal Lecter of wrestling.
I just tried to use a side of my personality that didn't involve anything nice.
Mankind, born with a dream that turned into a nightmare.
I never had the chance to show the world that I could love and could be loved. I'm gonna eat you alive! I'm gonna stay!
Yes, yes, yes!
Little comments start coming out and people are, instead of saying, hey, I'm scared of that guy, they say, I kind of get a kick out of that guy. And besides, man, he's suffering for our sake.
Hunter Helms is a character that's supposed to hit a raw nerve. He's like a snob. He's a character that fans will never love. They're always gonna hate him.
Their boos become cheers, you know. When I've got my guy down that they wanna see beat my ass, and I've got him beat up, and I stand over him and look out at the people and do that little bow, and they just boo me out of the building, that's the reaction I want. And when I do that, I go, yeah, because I got him.
Don't ask me why they love him, but they sure do. He's as ornery as a rattlesnake.
Something strange has been happening. The guys the American fans are supposed to hate are becoming the heroes. Take Stone Cold Steve Austin, the most evil guy in the Federation.
If you put the letter S in front of Hitman, you've had my exact opinion of Bret Hart.
fans started to turn against me and really get off on him. I'm like, he's so bad, he's cool. In the end, the fans decide everything. If they cheer you, you're a good guy. If they boo you, you're a heel. McMahon recognized the way the crowd's reacting to Austin, and it's positioning him to be a fan favorite. I don't think there are any good guys anymore. People seem to be sick of good guys. McMahon talked to me about changing my character. He wants me to turn heel, become a bad guy. At first, I was lukewarm to the idea. I've always taken so much pride in being the hero. Finally, he sold me on the idea. I guess there's only so many times you can rescue the girl on the railroad tracks without people getting bored with it.
Why'd you give me this, like, sissy shirt?
Hey, what do you mean?
Give me one of my shirts. This is one of Julie's shirts. It's a little too effeminate.
So the plans for me and Austin basically changed places all in one match. Like a classic good guy, Steve will never give up. And like a real villain, I'm gonna kick him when he's down.
Wait a minute, what's Brett doing? Good God! Come on, Brett! Just now, what's up? Brett Hart, right to the camp!
And just like that, I'm a bad guy.
What about this transformation of Bret Hart?
Well, you heard the booze.
I have to think about not being a good guy anymore. You end up kind of finding the vein of reality in it. And I found that. My feelings towards the fans and saying, you don't have any heroes anymore. You don't believe in good and bad and right and wrong. If you cheer a guy like Steve Austin, then I can't accept you anymore.
No.
And the truth is, I don't see the fan side of it. I can take that thread of reality and sew it into my storyline and make it work for me. I don't have a problem being the bad guy. As long as I don't sell out my true fans, I don't want to become this slimy bad guy wrestler just to appease Vince McMahon or to sell tickets. So you don't sell that really cheap and just go, okay, hey, it's just a wrestling show. I've learned that it's not just a wrestling show.
Here I am in the middle of the ring pleading for my life with this horrible bad guy who is being cheered by everybody. And he's smashing my knee to pieces, just smashing it with a chair. And they loved every minute of it.
Look at this sadistic man!
But when you put yourself in my shoes, you go, what a bunch of cold-blooded people that they would turn their backs on me and allow this guy and cheer him on to do that to me and to end my career and to... And that's really been the underlying premise or theme all the way through my character is right.
Open the door.
Watch his knee.
I told you we're going straight down.
Steve Austin got rid of the driver and commenced beating me up in the ambulance. It was one of the best shows they ever did. The night after, I gave this huge monologue explaining all my grievances with the wrestling fans who had kind of turned their backs on me.
Nobody glorifies criminal conduct like the Americans do. In all the countries that I go to around the world, they still respect what's right and what's wrong. You American wrestling fans, coast to coast, you don't respect me. Well, the fact is, I don't respect you. So from here on in, the American wrestling fans, coast to coast, can kiss my ass.
Listen, this chorus of boos directed at Bret Hart.
It's a road that nobody's ever went down, trying to be a good guy everywhere else and a bad guy here. And I think the logic for me is to try to make the American wrestling fans get to be the bad guys.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Bret the Hitman Hart.
Thank you for letting me still be your hero. And thank you for believing in me. A few weeks ago, I was told, America, love it or leave it. I've been all over the United States of America, and the one thing that I've in particular looked forward to is loving leaving it. For me, Canada's a country where we still take care of the sick and the old, where we still have health care. We got gun control. We don't shoot each other and kill each other on every street corner. Canada isn't riddled with racial prejudice and hatred. Across Canada, we all care for each other. And I am proud to be Canadian. And I am proud to be your hero.
On the face of this earth.
I said the United States of America was one big, giant toilet bowl. If you were gonna give the United States of America an enema, you'd stick the hose right here in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
That wasn't my idea to say that. I'm urged, I'm not forced, but I'm urged to say this so really get them going. And in retrospect, now looking back, I think it was a mistake to say that. That's not me. I wouldn't have said that, and I don't personally think that if I was going to stick the hose in the United States, I certainly wouldn't look at Pittsburgh.
Maybe Washington.
One thing I've learned is that Americans will do absolutely anything to screw you.
Why does Canada suck?
Because they said we suck. They started this war.
USA's gonna finish it!
USA!
You're an American,
yes.
Carrying a Canadian flag.
That's right.
Why?
Because the American fans are way over, they're just too patriotic. I wore this shirt, I took this flag out there. I got called an idiot, a moron. They don't even know me. I don't know them. I haven't come out here and said the United States sucks or anything like that. I mean, maybe Canada does suck, or, you know, it's just not right, you know, to say stuff like that. Bret Hart's come to this country and he's wrestled in front of all of these fans and given them years and years of service and won titles, and he's done it all. And now just because he's taken the Canadian flag and he's taken his family around him, they've just turned against him. He never turned against his fans. They turned against him.
Canada is a bunch of crybabies. They can't stand their own 2 feet. United States, they fought. They got all the rights to do what they want. They are the best people in the world. I don't care what anyone says, United States is number one.
Well, don't we as Americans say that we love our children? How do we love them if we got a fool like Stone Cold Steve Austin and Shawn Michaels, one running around in Playgirl with a belly button ring in it, and don't even realize one thing? More men look at that magazine than women.
If you take a
America for all it's worth in all of its different little areas by any means necessary. Just take a look at corporate America, and I need I say more. Any means necessary. They step on a little guy and they take what they want. Win any way you can.
Brett, I think that's one grape that needs to be squashed. And tonight, The Undertaker will bury his Canadian ass.
Yeah.
About 9 months ago, all these people would have been cheering him. I don't think they would have been saying stuff like this. This is really disgusting. I like Bret Hart because he has family values. He's loyal. He really genuinely likes his fans. Even though he may hate what the morals of America, there are some people who believe in exactly what he believes in, you know? He really inspired me to do many different things with my life. He taught me how to, that I had a gift to take it to my fullest extent. So now I'm going to school for computer graphics. And I owe it all to Brett because 4 years ago, I wouldn't be going to school and now I'm gonna graduate. Because I just didn't believe in anything else. When I started liking Brett, everything changed.
Every once in a while you meet a little kid that's really down about it, wishes I would change back, wants me to be the hero. They try to understand it. And I don't really have any real great answers for him either. Hopefully when this thing's all over that I won't have, I hope, damaged that relationship. If I did, I would kind of feel that I, you know, maybe in some ways maybe made a wrong decision.
I'm still kind of worried about this thing with Sean in the sense that I'm not going to lose all my heat to him, am I? I mean, they're going to...
I don't think so. What, you have any idea what kind of finish you guys are going to do?
All I know is that Sean's going to cost Taker the match. Is Sean going to be a heel then?
That's what I understand.
Yeah. So it's almost like he's going to scoop my heat.
What's going to happen in the next matchup? Shawn Michaels cares about his own career and obviously also cares in a negative way as it relates to the Hitman Bret Hart. What sort of emotion is Shawn Michaels feeling as a guest referee?
Are you kidding me? Shawn Michaels' ego is so big that it's got its own zip code, McMahon. All he cares about is what his hair looks like out here tonight. And you know what? Speaking of The Undertaker, Shawn Michaels, I mean, he's so full of himself. When he goes to a funeral, he's upset because he's not the corpse. He wants to be the center of attention. And tonight, some kind of way, he will manage to be the center of attention in this match.
Pacing the cage.
I think he's got about another 10 years of wrestling left in him.
10 more years of wrestling? Well, like a guy wandering around the prison yard that's a lifer. You know, I got the nicest cell in the whole prison. And I got the, you know, the run of the place, and I got the kind of got the warden in my back pocket kind of thing, but I can't wait to get out. As soon as I get out, it'll be the real test. You know, it's like that Shawshank Redemption, to see if I can, you know, actually get out on the outside and stay out. I'm bound and determined to live a normal existence. Blade, you got that thing ready? Because I can come up and look at it now.
Yeah.
I've been gone a lot, which has been unfair to my wife. Julie's been left with most of the dirty work. I can't say I've been the greatest husband over the last 14 years.
Punch him, Dad.
You're throwing me around pretty good there, boy.
Press those buttons, Dad.
I asked you. You told me not to push those ones.
I said push those buttons. Those are move buttons.
Maybe the hitman can win one this time.
I don't know how Julie ever put up with it, me being gone all the time. It's been almost 18 or 19 years of saying I'll be home tomorrow.
Are you looking forward to the day when Brett hangs up his boots?
I've been waiting since he was 25, Paul. You know? So what? It's been 18 years now. You know? I'm sure he'll be involved in it somehow. You know?
You've had enough.
Yeah. I think it's time to be normal.
Are you ready?
Like I knows Canada. Hit the footage, Daddy-O.
Here, look at there.
Look at that way up there. That tickle your brain?
Oh, yeah.
You know something, Hitman? I'm younger than you.
Everybody's younger than him.
Everybody. I'm better than you.
Everybody's better than him.
And I'm certainly bigger than you in more ways than one.
Good God, you're gonna put an eye out with that thing.
I can't imagine what their thinking is. I can't imagine Vince McMahon sitting around a table going, well, why don't we try this tonight? Sean will pull his pants down and show the crack of his ass to everybody, and then he's jumping around. I wish I could be in the room and go, you guys nuts? It's become smut TV.
Favor if I go back to WCW and see if I can get my old deal.
The company's in financial peril.
I don't believe that. Less than a year ago, he came to our house to ask you to stay with him. He signed to 20 years with you.
I think I was sorry when I signed the deal. Brett had leveraged himself against Turner's operation and bid himself up so much, and everyone around me at that time was saying, oh, no, you can't let Brett go. I listened to them. I think I'm sorry that I did.
Just talk to Vince.
Did you?
Yep.
What do you say?
He goes, nobody wants Bret Hart more than Vince McMahon.
Then why is he letting you go?
He can't afford to compete with Turner. He was Turner's hell-bent on trying to put him out of business.
I gotta think about everything.
Just see what makes sense. I call Eric, maybe. I don't know. Can we cut this off now for a little while?
Okay. The WCW called me. I thought the deal had fallen through. And they said, what is it gonna take to bring you here? That's pretty much it. And I hung up, and I've got that pit in my stomach. I have every reason to leave now. I've got a deal. Still giving Vince McMahon the benefit of the doubt, the history and the legacy and my past. I thought about it all night, and I called him up in the morning, and I said, talk me into staying. That's exactly what I said. Talk me into staying.
I don't want to talk money. I'll stay for the deal that we have. I just want you to make some kind of a commitment to me.
Finally, he laid it out to me, like, what do you want to do? You make the call. I don't have any ideas. What would you do with Bret Hart? And then I realized what kind of a horrible predicament that I'm in. I came from being the number one good guy in the whole world. And I gave that job up to become the number one bad guy. And now you've given my bad guy job to Shawn Michaels. How can I become a good guy again? I've bashed the American people. That's where I perform 95% of the time. I'm stuck in limbo. I'm in purgatory. I can't be a great good guy, and I can't be a great bad guy anymore. I'm stuck with nothing. You've actually sabotaged my career. Finally faxed my, and finally ended my career, 14 years with the WWF. But I can't help but feel really heartbroken and disappointed that
that I left this company. And I punched in the numbers, and I remember I really had to just wait and hesitate before I pushed the send button. And I watched my career end in about 20 seconds, just...
Four more weeks and I'm out of the WWF. We've all agreed to keep my leaving a secret. But I'm not gonna shut up about how I'm feeling about where wrestling's headed.
Off the record with Michael Landsberg.
A week before the Survivor Series in Montreal, and wrestling fans are buzzing on the card is Bret Hart and the Heartbreak Kid Shawn Michaels. But the real fight is between Hart and the king of the WWF, Vince McMahon. Hart says it's a raunchier, sleazier WWF, not fit for kids. Hart fired the opening salvo, challenging the creative direction that McMahon is taking wrestling.
It's got a lot more raunchier, a lot more sexual. The show's very, very sexual, and I think in a bad way. I don't think you watch wrestling for sex. I don't think it's become something presentable to your children. Like my kids won't watch the show anymore. None of them, not even the teenagers. And it's just become something I don't really want to associate myself with.
Vince McMahon disagrees, and here's his answer.
We in the WWF think that you, the audience, are quite frankly tired of having your intelligence insulted. We also think that you're tired of the same old simplistic theory of good guys versus bad guys. Surely the era of the superhero who urged you to say your prayers and take your vitamins is definitely passé.
He says that there's no good or bad anymore. There's no black or white, just shades of gray. According to Vince, then, is there no right or wrong anymore?
In a way, it's a little piece of sleight of hand trickery he's doing here. We could have complex stories that won't offend kids. You can have moral relativism without having racist or sexist slurs.
It's a way to justify anything as being okay, whatever's convenient at the time. It's a way to justify if they want to do men beating up women, if they want to do racism. Since there's no good and evil, anything is allowable.
Henry, do you have a problem with that?
But this is not a unique offense of Vince McMahon. I mean, we market Freddy Krueger costumes for 9-year-olds.
True.
And quite frankly, throwing out the rules has made a much more exciting WWF entertainment. I mean, I may be morally and politically upset by some of what's going on, but as a fan, I'm not being treated like a baby in the way that I was when Vince would have two wrestlers in a diaper match. You know,
So instead of doing a diaper match, we're doing a stripper match.
Isn't that the point that Bret Hart's been making, is that this just is not appropriate for kids?
I went public with my feelings about the WWF's creative direction. But Vince leaked it out that I was leaving the WWF for the money, that I sold out. Detroit would be my last show before the match in Montreal. Fans were starting to get really, really hot, and I was starting to get as emotional as they were.
Things got really messed up. This thing is really messed up. It's just not a happy group at all. I know.
Where I am right now with Sean,
I told Vince it's got to the point, you know, he said Stu's dead and all this stuff on his interview.
He said yeah. Stu's dead?
Stu's yeah. dead.
When did he say that?
2 weeks ago.
That's a question sad.
Yeah, it's Vince's fault. Vince said to me, he goes, I want you to really shoot with him on this interview. And they sat, me, Vince, and Sean sat there. We went over all these things that they wanted me to say, you know. Tap into him sort of being gay and hit into this and get on him about that. And I'm like going, you want me to say these things? And Sean's like, yeah, hit me with this and hit me with that. And then I'm going after it. It's like, I feel really uncomfortable. I'm doing the same thing to you that I'm asking you not to do to me. You know, this is getting stupid.
You need to get a hold of this to Fabio right away.
Really, the whole thing's getting stupid. It's
built to the level where the babyface, the hero, has to prevail.
I talked to Vince and he says I have to lose to Sean in Montreal. He told me I can't have me showing up on the WCW TV show wearing his belt. I said I would never do that. I said, fine, if you want me to drop the belt, I'll drop the belt, but not in Canada. He insisted, says I have to lose in Montreal. I said, you told me I could leave any way I wanted, and now you're throwing this at me? This is really strange. I've never said no to Vince McMahon, ever. I think I've compromised enough. You know, I had it put in my contract. For the last 30 days, I have reasonable creative control. And now I'm in a situation where, thank God I put that in.
Yeah. What if something happens regardless?
Well, I don't have to worry about the referee tomorrow because I talked to Earl. He swore on his kids that he's not going to let anything happen. And I can trust Earl.
I told him, Vince, that it would be a blow now to me, beat me in Canada with the momentum that I have as a Canadian hero. And it'd be a blow to most of the people across the country, which ultimately will affect my going into the WCW now.
The thing that bothered me was why Vince would be so anxious to...
get rid of me?
Have you leave his company, because you'd always done an excellent job for him.
I've missed two shows in 14 years. I think it's a modest request, especially in light of the fact that he told me that that I could leave any way I want to. For my last 30 days of my contract, I got reasonable creative control. Like, we can't do anything either way that isn't mutually acceptable to either party. Now I can drop the belt to him on national television in front of the whole world. You can tape it and film it and play it over and over and over if that's what you want. But let me get through this weekend. Don't let me disgrace myself and the Canadian fans.
When you lose your respect, you haven't got much left.
No matter what Bret Hart does, we want him to know that we're behind him 100%. We love the Hitman, no matter where he goes or what he does. He's over here.
Thanks for coming out and seeing me. Okay.
I love you, Brett.
I love you, too.
They're the best.
We love the whole Hart Foundation. They rock.
They're the best.
Like, he sees Sean and it makes him sick because his children are watching. He doesn't want his children exposed. Brett speaks the truth.
He will always be my hero.
He's always my hero.
He's our hero.
I love him with all my heart.
Tomorrow's the big showdown in Montreal. It's probably the biggest fight of my whole life.
I can't do it. I described it to Vince, I just assume blow my brains out would be the same. From a character standpoint, that's what I would be doing. Bret the Hitman Hart would blow his brains out. Really, what they would prefer to do to me tomorrow is to, a way I would liken it, is to actually rape me in the middle of the ring. And it'll be really tough for me to get through the next few weeks if I even make it that far. I have no idea if I make it that far, because I won't let them rape me. Anyway, it was hard. The whole thing's been hard.
There has been a lot of speculation. This will be Bret Hart's last match in the WWF.
I didn't know anything until like Friday. I found out from the ECW crew.
Yeah.
I was like, you're kidding me.
Yeah, I think everyone's kind of in shock.
It's gonna be like a huge void.
Oh yeah. He's 28. Huge void.
It's like, there's never been a time when he wasn't here.
Breaks my heart.
Bowser!
Sure enough.
Kind of weird all this.
Yeah, I'm gonna miss Bret. Yep, I'll miss him.
It's gotta hurt.
It's all right, no problem. Yeah, well, I'm gonna stay in touch. I'm gonna call you guys.
Make sure we hang out. Is he doing all right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, he's okay.
All right.
Okay. So we're gonna hang out. Kids have all grown up with them, like all of them, you know? It's just kind of funny hugging everyone and going, okay, take care and stay in touch. And you know that they mean well. They, you know, they are going to stay in touch some of them. You'll never see any of these guys again, you know? It'll just be a memory.
A lot of guys here that are friends.
With me. Apparently everyone knows me.
So sort of what's it feel like? Sort of like losing friends? Or?
Yeah, kind of.
Do you understand why your dad's moving?
Go mess around, all right? I gotta just talk.
Right up this way, let me show you.
I never ever wanted to leave here with any kind of bad feeling, but this week has been a bad week for me. I feel kind of betrayed a little bit.
Well, I do too, a little bit. And again, all we're talking about really is Ted Turner. That's what's coming between you and me, and that's all. I can't tell you how appreciative I will always be for everything you've done.
I didn't want to leave with any problems. I actually didn't want to leave at all. And then it's the point where there was no other choice but to go. The way this whole thing has been depicted, it's really hard for me as a hero here to come up short this weekend. What would you want to do today, then?
I'm open to anything.
I think what I'd like to do is get through today. I think tomorrow I should just go in and do my speech and forfeit the title. I think it allows me a chance to leave with my head up and leave in a nice way. I mean, I don't have to beat Sean. We could have a schmoz or whatever you want.
I would think it'd be a run-in type thing. But I'm open to anything.
No, I think that's...
I'm open to anything. Like I said before, I'm determined this is going to wind up the right way.
They're going to be watching you like a motherfucker. Back if it takes too long for you to get up class.
Do you feel comfortable with that? I want to run this by Vince because when you come back, we have it all ironed out.
Yeah.
I want to have it ironed out before all the other boys start jumping in.
Finally agreed that I didn't have to lose the belt, that I could leave with my head up.
Two of the most dominant and two of the most premier perennial great athletes in the history of the WWF. But folks, this is very, very personal. This match is going to be stiff.
Make it a three shot.
Vince, I'm going to put you on the hot seat now. Who's going to win?
I don't know.
Thank you.
Okay, we bumped the referee.
Right.
Now the referee's supposed to stay down, and then Sean goes for the sharpshooter.
I see.
I reverse it, put it on him.
Okay.
Then the other guys eventually come down. The whole thing ends up in a big schmoz. That's the way it's supposed to end.
To me, that sounds good.
I reached around to grab Sean's leg, and I could hear someone say, "Ring the bell." That's when I knew it was Vince McMahon. I finally realized that they screwed me. They really screwed me, the lousy bastards. A chance to leave with my head up and leave in a nice way.
Whatever you want.
Okay. Shit's locked himself in his office.
I swear to God. He's yelling at me out there. I gave him a belt when I came back here. I will not have any part of it.
Hey, Vince.
Swing around, get the shot.
Maybe if you got shit.
He's got it. Okay, let's get out.
Okay, close the door.
Hold on. That's here now?
So would you guys all have a meeting this afternoon and decide the whole thing? Don't give me that shit. Because you guys knew it.
I swear to God.
You knew it from the very beginning. All of you.
I swear to God, I knew nothing about this.
Yeah, well, swear to God all you want. Someday God is going to strike you down.
I mean,
yeah.
I know you're upset, but...
No, I am upset.
I had nothing to do with it. I didn't know anything about this.
You had just as much to do with it as the rest of them.
I knew nothing about it.
I'm sure you didn't. I'm sure you didn't. That really sucks, you know. You all go back to the hotel and have a big laugh, right? A few beers, you know. Just remember someday, Hunter, what goes around comes around.
I have nothing to say to him.
Yeah, well, you don't have anything to say.
I told you nothing about it.
Oh.
Hold on, grab one. What happened?
Somehow Vince ran into my hand, but I drilled him.
Really? About as hard as I could. Knocked him right out.
You knocked Dill's pants back down with a punch?
And I told him to get out.
Don't look at the camera, try and look for him.
And I think when the smoke cleared, it was like the right thing to do. You know, that was the right thing to do. There was no other choice but to get up and punch Vince one time and then let it go. That's a Stu Hart judgment call.
If you had the opportunity to speak with Brett, because you know he's watching, what would you say to him now?
It's too bad that a 14-year relationship was destroyed because one member of that relationship forgot that we're in the sports entertainment business. Forgot where he came from. Bret Hart screwed Bret Hart, and he can look in the mirror and know that.
Vince McMahon has always had this mentality about treating wrestlers like circus animals. All these wrestlers that have broke their backs making this living for years end up with nothing when it's over. And then they sort of take you out back and they put a slug in the back of your head and dump you out in a... That's the life of a professional wrestler. And in my case, the demands that I made and the things that I won over from a contract standpoint were all demands that put the power back into the wrestler's hands somewhat. Maybe that's what they want to do. Maybe I was becoming too powerful. And now it's time for Vince McMahon, the promoter, to tear this guy down. Maybe it's just something that he just wanted to prove to himself that he could still do it. I'll never know, but I know that he was wrong.
Is there a right and is there a wrong?
There's Bret Hart's argument, which may seem a bit naive, but to go back to something like Hamlet, you know, Hamlet finds himself in a world in which he can find no moral values, but he still has personal integrity. He keeps his word. He does what he promises he will do, and that makes him a good man, even if he's in a bad world.
Ladies!
It's almost a fitting end to the Hitman character, because he never sold out and he never lost his integrity. Bret Hart came home, he's fine. What they did is they murdered this Hitman character.
Sometimes the best map will not guide you. You can't see what's round the bend. Sometimes the road leads to dark places. Sometimes the darkness is your friend. Today these eyes scan a bleached out land. I'm pacing the cage. I'm pacing the cage.